One thing we hear on NPR that we hear almost nowhere else in quite the same way is the revealing sound of a voice.
A lot of things are moving in the right direction.
Might be the Secretary of State or a person on the street.
How do you happen to know this? You're a police officer.
But in this collection, we feature voices of a different sort. Primal and musical, full of mystery and meaning. Birds fascinate us. Why do they sing? What do they sing? Where do they live? What do they do when we're not around? You'll find some extraordinary stories here. Hummingbirds who return to say hello to their adopted human mother. Jealous lady ant birds and their resourceful mates. Yellow-throated warblers blown off course on the streets of Chicago. These stories tell us a lot about birds. And those of us who do the watching. Commentator Julie Zicafus rescues birds in distress as a licensed wildlife rehabilitator. It's a hands-on job requiring skill and patience and the occasional high-tech gadget.
When a cascade of twigs, leaves, and rootlets appeared on the elbow of our downspout, I watched to see a little brown wren trying to make a great wad of nesting material stay on the slippery metal. I caught the bird's eye. "Wait right here. I'm going to help you." I ran to the garage, grabbed a little copper bucket, some wire, and a stepladder. I climbed the ladder, wired the bucket up under the eave, placed the nesting material in the little pail, and climbed down the ladder. The wren perched on the gutter just a few feet away, watching. Before I got the ladder folded, the wren appeared with a bill full of moss and put it in its new home. By nightfall, the nest was nearly complete. Since that day, 5 years ago, 30 or more baby Carolina wrens have been raised in the copper pail, and we've watched the fledglings flutter out time and time again, adding motion and music to our lives. There were 5 nestlings this summer, and they lined up on the downspout before making their first stuttering flights into the world. Well, 4 of them did. When Carolina wrens leave the nest, they don't mess around. One minute, everything's quiet. The next minute, baby birds are shooting out of the nest like popcorn. The parent birds work in shifts, calling and encouraging the young to hop and flutter to the nearest deep cover. Somehow, the adult birds keep them all together and feed them for the next 3 weeks as their wings strengthen and foraging skills develop. So I was alarmed to find one baby wren, all bright eyes and yellow clown lips, still perched by the bucket after its 4 siblings had gained the safety of the woods. Surely a parent would return for it. 1 hour, then 2 went by, and the fledgling was hungry, chirping constantly for help. Oh dear, I did not want to be a teenage wren's mother for the next 3 weeks. I listen, nothing from the silent woods. By now, the family could be hundreds of yards away. What to do? It was time for a little technology. I grabbed my iPod, which is fully loaded with the songs and calls of nearly every North American bird. I ran to the edge of our woods and dialed up the song of the Carolina wren. "Please, please, let this work." I played it at full volume. No response. Desperate, I dialed up the alarm call of the wren and blasted it down into the silent tangle of raspberry and sumac. "Danger, danger," the recording shrilled in wren speak. An adult wren shot right past my head, flying straight toward the forgotten baby in the copper bucket. The recalcitrant fledgling buzzed out to meet it. Baby wren, last seen, headed toward the safety of the woods in the company of a parent.
Commentator Julie Zicafus. Every summer, an invasion overwhelms the tiny island of St. Lazaria, off the southwest coast of Alaska. Swarms of seabirds, called storm petrels, descend to breed. We're going to descend into the middle of this mass of birds with biologist Michael Anderson.
It's nighttime, and so the birds are coming in and flying all about, upwards of 500,000 birds that we're talking about. These birds are actually digging burrows in the soft, moist soil in the forested areas. And so they're coming in through the forest, landing on the ground, and going underneath the ground, tunneling into their burrows to lay an egg. This nocturnal shift is sort of the changing of the guard, where one bird comes back in and exchanges incubation duties while the other bird goes out to do some foraging, and they're making these vocalizations to help recognize one another individually in this sort of sea or mass of birds. There are two species here, and each gives a unique vocalization. The fork-tailed storm petrel has this one that just gives 3 to 5 grating notes, like a yap, 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 yap. And the leech's storm petrel is giving this more of a purring sound as they fly through the trees. Oftentimes they're crashing through the limbs of the trees, stumbling down to the ground, and then scurrying about, calling to their mate, trying to find their particular burrow. There are just so many of these birds that they can't help but flying into the microphone or the tripod, or even one time bird flew right into my head.
Biologist Michael Anderson. Here's NPR's Melissa Block.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.